We are really very, very happy to have Professor Lewis Bruce to give us this talk. It is Professor Bruce received his PhD in chemical physics from Columbia in 1969, joined Bell Labs in 1973, and then after some years, went back to Columbia in 1996. He is now the Samuel Mitchell Professor. Professor Bruce is a chemist who can explain things to physicists. He is a physicist who can explain things to chemists. But if any of you who are neither physics or chemists, I'm sure you can understand his talk also, because he can explain things to anyone. He is a member of the U.S. National Academy of Science, also the Norwegian Academy of Science and Letters, a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and the American Physical Society. How about Chemistry Society?
They just started fellows a few years ago. I haven't tried to.
Okay, so physicists actually, okay. He has received many prestigious awards, and if I read them all, then it takes up most of the time, so I'll just tell you two of them. He has the Kavli Prize for Nanoscience in 2008 for his contribution to invent the quantum dots. And he's also received an INAS award in chemical sciences in 2010. I think I was there when the university had that celebration for you, right? Yeah, you said that was your time for the to be honored. That was your. So I remember that. So we are very, very happy that Professor Bruce can come to tell us about carbon nanoscience and electronic structure. And I'm really happy to see that there are many younger people here. When I asked Professor Bruce who he wanted to see, he said, younger people. So therefore, you know, I'm excluded. But so I'm very happy to see all of you here. And so, and I guess you can ask questions, right? If during the lecture, and so I will not take more time, Lewis.
Can you hear me all right? So I'm really happy to be here. My first visit to Hong Kong and to visit such a well-known and strong university and to meet the faculty and to hear all of the things that the people are doing, it's a great, great honor for me. Here's a picture of New York. Columbia is also even more than this school, a urban campus. You see, in the north, Columbia is on the left here. Oh, I can point at this, right? Yeah. So Columbia campus at 120th and Broadway, Barnard campus across the street. This is the undergraduate women's college. And Central Park is over here, Midtown Manhattan, Hudson River flowing from north to south, and New Jersey on the right-hand side. And it looks very nice here. The sun is setting over New Jersey. This is picture is taken from the top of our new interdisciplinary science building between chemistry and the physics over here. So today I thought I would give a talk about some ideas which have been in my mind for the last 2 or 3 years. And this is not a normal research sort of seminar based on what we've been accomplishing in my own lab. But it's kind of a tutorial seminar on what I think is extremely interesting about nanoscience. Okay? And so he will cover mainly focusing on electron correlation in nanoscience, start and mentioning all these different things as we go through the talk. So what's the motivation for doing this work? Motivation is nanoscience and solar energy. How can we use nanostructures to absorb sunlight? how can we separate charge after photon absorption? What are the essential issues? And this leads automatically to what's the true nature of excited electronic states in nanostructures. And so the take-home lesson from this talk is that, like quantum dots are zero-dimensional systems and ordinary semiconductors are three-dimensional systems, electron correlation and the effects of electron correlation are very strong in one-dimensional and two-dimensional systems in nanoscience. And we're just understanding that in the last couple of years. They're quite weak in quantum dots and in 3D systems. Okay, so I'm a chemist, and I'm going to talk a lot about carbon nanotubes and graphene, and so it's important to start from small molecules so that we can see the connection to graphene and carbon nanotubes. So here's the Huckel molecular orbital problem as we teach it to the undergraduates for butadiene over here. SP2 hybridization, four carbons, four electrons, four p electrons. And the most important thing is the exchange coupling from the overlap of one carbon, one basis orbital to the next, bonding overlap, beta resonance integral, and solving for the electronic structure. Four molecular orbitals coming from four basis orbitals, spin up and spin down. So this is the electronic structure that's well known to everyone in the room. Excited electronic state would go from here to here on a loud transition. So this would absorb in the ultraviolet. This is the independent electron picture. We're just considering the nearest neighbor coupling. If I move an electron from here to here and say that's the excited state, that means that this excited electron doesn't really care anything about the other pi electrons. That's not true experimentally. This is only a model. But the mixing, this correlation that exists in the molecule will cause the mixing. But because these orbitals are very far apart to begin with, mixing is rather small. So this is a good picture, good picture. We can just go straight like this and take it for the excited state. We do the Huckel problem for benzene. A new element comes in here in the sense that if you have high symmetry, in this case hexagonal symmetry, you get degeneracy of molecular orbitals, and this is all through science you see like this. This is a case where we have six pi electrons and six molecular orbitals. Everyone knows this. Now we go to graphene. So what happens in graphene, the energy bands of graphite or graphene involve exactly the same Huckel problem that I've talked to you about already. This is the band structure of graphene, and here's the energy levels as a function of the translational momentum. And you see there's this T here, which is the coupling matrix element from one carbon to the next. And it's exactly the same as the beta on the previous slides. This is exactly, again, the same problem, the Huckel molecular orbital problem. We have also, as in the case of benzene, we have high symmetry. The high symmetry causes, well, as everyone knows, you have in the band structure of graphene, you have these occupied pi orbitals in the lower sheet, the unoccupied pi star orbitals on the upper sheet. Because of the high symmetry, the highest occupied molecular orbital comes down and just touches the lowest empty molecular orbital right here at the K point. And we have an infinite size, so we have an infinite number of molecular orbitals. So every point on this lower sheet, every single point is a molecular orbital that has two electrons in it, one spin up and one spin down. And the new element here, because of translational symmetry, the momentum of the electron is a good quantum number, and so every electron is characterized by a momentum. So most electrons in graphene think that they are in a semiconductor. And if you just pick one specific random value of momentum, you have an optical transition from a pi to a pi star, and there's a band gap in between. It's only for these K points where the band gap goes to zero. So the density of states at the Fermi level is vanishing in the picture. So in terms of this discussion of correlation, the issue is, to what extent is this picture correct? Can we actually use this picture to predict the excited electronic states? What are the deviations from it? Deviations will be stronger here because the zero order states are essentially degenerate. And so for the correlation-induced mixing, is far stronger, and we'll see that as we go through this. All right. So as I said, this is the independent electron model, no correlation. And as a chemist, what I really like about this, that it is just a branch. This is the branch of aromatic molecular photophysics and aromatic photochemistry that organic chemists know a huge amount all about already. So we should be able to understand very much of what's going on in these systems just from the extrapolation from the smaller molecules. So let's now think a little bit about the optical spectra of these systems, and then we'll see to what extent it's actually true in experiment. So as everyone knows, in graphite, you'd expect continuous optical transitions all the way from the infrared to the ultraviolet. So as I say, this lower cone represents the occupied molecular orbitals. There are two electrons at each point here. So these two electrons right here have a vertical transition to the empty pi star orbital right there. So you expect transitions in the infrared, the visible, and the ultraviolet, continuous. And it's a curiosity that if the actual absorption coefficient is simply pi divided by the fine structure constant, maybe 2.3% per sheet. That's the prediction. Continuous absorption across the entire spectrum. And that's pretty much true. Here's a measurement. If we get far enough into the seminar, I'll show you later on the apparatus for taking this measurement. But this is simply one layer of graphene, two layers of graphene, three layers of graphene. Right there, you see the zero, or the baseline runs across like that. So from here to here is the absorption of one layer, 2% roughly, 2.6 per layer across the entire visible, as you'd expect. Since these are van der Waals material, the absorption of two layers is pretty much twice the absorption of a single layer. There's little interaction from one layer to the next, and so you can see that here. But you can also see that the absorption is beginning to rise as we go into the ultraviolet, and something else is going on. So what's going on in the ultraviolet? Well, if we look in the ultraviolet, we have one of the first indications that correlation is actually very strong in graphene and beginning to change things from this simple picture. So I've been talking about the infrared and the visible transitions right around the K point from there to there, from here to here, from here to here. And that gives this sort of gray continuum across the infrared and the visible. But you see, as you go into the ultraviolet, you come up towards the M point here, all the optical transition from right there to right there, piles up with the one next to it. Because the band is flat like this, you expect a peak in the optical absorption. And if the band structure interpretation is correct, then it's the joint density of states that gives this peak in the ultraviolet. It should be a symmetric transition like this. That's the prediction. But in fact, it's very different. You see, the experimental data shows this asymmetric peak in the ultraviolet. So there is the peak there, but if something funny is going on, this peak has a Fano line shape. Curious, you know, it's an asymmetric peak, shifted a little bit from the prediction. Now, this kind of asymmetric line shape, this Fano line shape in science generally represents the interference between the absorption to a bound state and absorption to a continuum. And so there's clearly some kind of bound state up here at the end point in addition to the continuous absorption. You see, if we go straight down low here, we have this flat spectrum that I've been talking about already. So the way to understand that is that an exciton forms at the M saddle point. Even though the system is metallic, the screening is not enough to kill it. So what do I mean by that? Well, the simple oversimplified picture is that, you know, if you promote an electron from a pi to a pi star, and if the band structure interpretation is correct, they both run in plane waves. So one runs like this, the other runs like this, and one doesn't really care about the presence of the other with no correlation. But in fact, you know, they attract each other with the Coulomb attraction. And one's positive and one's negative. And the Coulomb attraction should be especially strong in the graphene sheet because the screening is weak. After all, if you have, there's vacuum above and below the sheet like this. The electric field begins on a positive charge and it comes out of the graphene sheet and it comes back in and terminates on the negative charge, but most of it's running in the vacuum. So screening should be very low. So you expect a kind of a bound state between the electron and the hole as well as the possibility of dissociated states. So you have this bound state up there. For sure, it exists in principle. The question is the magnitude of the binding. That's the whole issue. If it's just a trivial amount or is it very strong? And to fit this thing, you know, to fit this thing, the binding energy is actually a quarter of an electron volt. It only lives for a few femtoseconds, but the binding energy is a quarter of an electron volt. So that's one of the first indications that the band structure picture of the graphene is wrong because of correlation. Another indication is carrier multiplication. If you excite in the blue here, as excited electrons and holes, they will come down and merge together at the Fermi level. And as they merge, they come down, they will show carrier multiplication. You'll get start with electron in the hole. You'll have two electrons and two holes, and they come down. Doesn't last very long because it's going very fast to the Fermi level. It's not particularly useful carrier multiplication because the system doesn't have a band gap, but it's there. Okay. Another thing which is really impressive to me is this very robust and strong fractional quantum Hall effect which exists in graphene. So I'm not a physicist and this is not my field, but again, as an oversimplified interpretation, what's going on here is you have a single sheet of graphene like this. And of course, if you have an electron, electrons run through it in plane waves. So they just, electron runs down the sheet. But if you put extremely strong magnetic field perpendicular to the sheet like this, what happens is that by the Lorentz force, electron starts moving, and then it has the force at right angles to make it go in little circles rather than move through the sheet in the band structure. As you put a really strong field, it doesn't go very far. In effect, you're removing the band structure from the problem entirely. Electrons just run in little circles regardless of what the band structure is. So you have all these kind of localized little electrons like this, but they still have charge on them. You know, so electrons interact with other electrons. And because the band structure is taken out, there's still a Coulomb interaction from one to the next. So you have this whole sea of electrons that are interacting with each other by the repulsive Coulomb interaction. That creates a extremely strongly correlated state that behaves as if it had a fractional charge. When Horst Stormer, Philip Kim originally saw this, they tried to understand the magnitude of the coupling. And the question is the extent of the screening, which I already talked about. And so basically, they can fit the temperature dependence of this fractional quantum Hall effect, assuming there's no screening at all. So very strong effect, much stronger than in gallium, than in layered semiconductors like this. It's strong because the system has no screening. And it's strong because it's a perfect material system. Big sheet of graphene without any disorder in it, without any defects, you know, perfectly crystalline system, very close to the theoretical idea. It's very hard to get that in any other flat system. And evidence of strong correlation in graphene. So thinking about this, if electron correlation is strong in graphene, it ought to be much stronger in carbon nanotubes. And there are two reasons for this. One is that one is lower dimensionality, and I'll try to explain in a few minutes this very important, this strong importance of dimensionality itself. There are basically two independent factors that are important here. One is dimensionality, and independent of that is screening on the other side, like this. Carbon nanotube is close to a one-dimensional system, not quite there, but close, and it has less screening because of the existence of a band gap. So let's think about that for a second. If you have a carbon nanotube like this and the lowest Van Hove singularity, optical absorption across the band gap of the tube, again, you could have dissociated states, the electrons and holes running down the length of the tube, or you can have bound pairs in the same way. A little bit like a hydrogen atom, you know, electron the hole circulating each other on the surface of the tube in a series of bound states. More bound states exist if the attraction potential is stronger, finite number but of states, then if there's enough energy, you'll have dissociated states as well. So again, that's a question of understanding these bound states, how far they exist below the continuum. And this is the problem. Well, let me first show the densities of states. So we made up this slide recently to kind of characterize these densities of states without any correlation now. Densities of states without any correlation. Here's our butadiene example over here. Here's a quantum dot, which I'll be talking about in a second. Quantum dot is like cadmium selenide, just similar to a molecule, discrete states closer together, band gap. Here's our one-dimensional carbon nanotube, metallic and semiconducting, very different density of states. What correlation does is put a new state inside the band gap here, this bound exciton state. So I'll be talking about this new state, which exists right here, and how strong it is and how deep it is inside the band gap. So this can be done by making a comparison of the two photon and the one photon absorption of the system, and I won't explain all of that other than to say the binding energy for the lowest excited state is actually running about 0.4 volts below the band gap of the system. It's quite strong binding for the exciton. You know, so these excitons are not thermally dissociated at room temperature. If you have a three-dimensional semiconductor like silicon or gallium arsenide, binding energy for the excitons a few MeV, and at room temperature they're dissociated and they don't count, they're not important for anything, basically. But if you think about this, if it's a hydrogenic exciton, let's remember what we know about the hydrogen atom, hydrogenic bound state, a state bound by central forces, the net binding energy is 1/2 of the Coulomb attraction. So basically you have a positive kinetic energy and a negative Coulomb attraction, and the difference between the two is the net binding energy. So if in fact the binding energy is 0.4 volts, that means that in this lower state, the Coulomb attraction between the electron and the hole is 0.8 volts in that analogy, in a system that has a band gap of 1.7 electron volts. So very strong. This is close to being the molecular limit as opposed to the solid state limit. So you have this very strong excited state, which is a neutral entity. And the whole excited state can move up and down the tube, left and right like this, but it's a neutral excited state. That's what you would expect in a molecule. Okay. To show strong correlation, I would show this picture that comes from an experiment of Fedenivoris's at IBM that I always had great admiration for. And the experiment that Fedden did was the following. He took a semiconducting nanotube and stretched it across a trench between the source and the drain, gold contacts like this, and then applied a voltage across the length of the tube and injected hot electrons from one side into the conduction band. And so here's this band structure picture of what's going on here. And there's electric field along the length of the carbon nanotube, and therefore the bands are bent like this. This is the valence band and the conduction band. So an electron is injected on one end and is accelerated, picks up energy as because of the field it senses along the length of the tube, goes faster and faster, becomes a hot electron. It's above the edge of the conduction band, as you can see crossed like this. And so what you'd normally expect from a hot electron like this is that it would couple with the vibrations and fall down to the conduction band and make heat. That's not what happens here in the carbon nanotube. And what happens is the electron goes faster and faster. And then when it reaches an energy which is, when it has enough energy to jump in one step all the way down to the edge of the conduction band, and the energy released here is used to create an electron hole pair across the conduction band. So this is impact ionization, and it's a direct result of coupling between the electrons. And this process conserves charge. You know, you start with one electron and you end up with two electrons and one hole. That's okay. It conserves momentum. It conserves energy. It doesn't violate any law of nature. It's just an electronic relaxation process for a hot electron moving in a tube that competes with the vibrational relaxation. And normally you would say that it's dead zero in rate. But in fact, in this case, it's running, you know, it's what you see is no heat production in the tube, and you see this tremendous amount of light coming off the tube, which corresponds to the band gap exciton value. Tube emits light like crazy, coming from this energy picked up by the injection. Being a good scientist, Fedden calculated, sat down with his collaborators to calculate the rate of exciton generation. So in fact, when you have enough energy to create the exciton here, and when it conserves everything, how fast is it? Calculation from the Fermi-Golden rule gives, in fact, 10 to the 15th per second. That's what he got. This extremely fast rate has been confirmed theoretically by Aaron Rabbani and his collaborators in Tel Aviv now. So this is the case. Uncertainty principle width for a process like this is 1 electron volt. So this hot electron lives for such a short time that it doesn't make sense to consider it a basic excitation of the system. It is so strongly coupled to the other electrons that, you know, if you try to create it, it's gone in 1 femtosecond. It's a limit of extremely strong correlation. So somehow our community here has, found by accident a regime of, in these one-dimensional systems, of ultra-high correlation. I don't know what's going to come out of this, but this, this is a remarkable, remarkable result. So why? Why does this strong correlation exist in the graphene and the carbon nanotube? So there's increased electron-electron correlation or interaction in nanostructures. And to be truth, what I mean by this here is the following. It's increased with respect to three-dimensional semiconductors. It's not increased with respect to molecules. But the consequences in one dimension and two dimensions of this electron-electron interaction are far more dramatic in one and two dimensions than they are in molecules because of this argument I gave earlier about the degenerate electronic states mixing versus the states very far apart mixing. As long as you have some residual band structure, you have either one-dimensional or two-dimensional system, you have states all piling up, you have continuous bands, and they can mix very strongly because of these correlations. So it was in Bell Labs, Stefan Schmidt-Rink, 30 years ago, a theorist who first started to think a little bit about these issues here. And Stefan realized he was working on gallium arsenide, aluminum gallium arsenide quantum wells back in those days. And he went through this mental argument of comparing three dimensions and two dimensional and one dimension. And so let me repeat his argument here. And suppose we have just a crystal of gallium arsenide like this. And we can form a three-dimensional exciton, electron in a hole circulating each other in three dimensions like a hydrogen atom. And we find that the binding is relatively weak there. In this same three-dimensional crystal, we can mathematically confine the electron in the hole to move in a plane. Screening is not changed because it's still gallium arsenide. And there's no vacuum nearby. Screening is not changed, but electron and hole are moving in a plane like this. Simply that change in dimensionality will increase the net binding energy by a factor of 4. In the lowest bound state of the, in the lowest bound state. And if you in fact do the thought problem of having electron hole move on a line in a three-dimensional semiconductor like this, back and forth on a line, the Coulomb interaction diverges in that case. And there's no distinction between bound states and dissociated states. The distinction still exists in two dimensions, but not in one dimension. So this dimensionality argument from Stefan is pointing very strongly towards one-dimensional systems as having very strong correlation, high Coulomb interactions. And the second thing that not so relevant to gallium arsenide, but it's relevant to the what I've already been talking about, to carbon nanotubes and to graphene and MOS2, is this decrease of the Coulomb interaction when the carriers are right on the surface. Coulomb interaction is weak because the carriers in pi orbitals, they're right on the surface. And it's very strong, as we've seen, fractional quantum Hall effect, effectively no screening in that particular experiment. Okay. So there's been a lot of interest in carbon, in quantum dots, cadmium selenide quantum dots, core shell quantum dots, and multiple exciton generation. And it's clear now there is multiple exciton generation in cadmium selenide, strong multiple exciton generation in carbon nanotubes. And I thought I would just repeat this argument that I've been talking about here to compare this system versus this system in terms of nanoscience. So if you have a zero-dimensional system because all three dimensions are small, quantum dot, and you put an electron and a hole in here, most important thing is that the electrons and holes are confined by the walls. Wave function has a node, has a maximum in the center of the particle and a node on the surface. particle in the sphere wave functions. And so the electron, the hole are in the same orbital in the center here, and the electron, the hole are doing their best to avoid going to the wall. And mixing is hard if the Coulomb interaction can be taken into account in first order perturbation theory here. So a system like this would have a band gap of 2 volts. It would have kinetic energies of 4/10 of a volt, a Coulomb interaction of 1/10 of a volt. Carbon nanotube, there is quantum confinement around the surface, but there's no quantum confinement along the length of the tube. So a bound state, as I've said, is simply caused by the interaction of the Coulomb interaction like this along the length of the tube of this sort. And kinetic energy is like in a hydrogen atom, kinetic energy 4/10 of a volt typically, Coulomb interaction 8/10 of a volt. So almost an order of magnitude from here to here in these systems. This is theoretical reason why correlation effects are much stronger here when there's a residual band structure along one length. The other thing which is very, very different between this system and this system is that this is almost a perfect material system. This is a bad material system. As I said earlier, you know, we can make carbon nanotubes and graphene that have almost structurally perfect and very rigid. You know, so no disorder, no defects, no intrinsic surface states. What we calculate from the simple quantum mechanics is what you actually get along the carbon nanotube like this. Here, because this is an sp3 system, not an sp2 system like this, you have broken valence at the surface like this. And in principle, you have a surface state for every atom on the surface. This can be taken into, if you make a core shell particle and put zinc sulfide on the surface of this thing, you eliminate many of the surface states, but not all of them. So this is a terrible material system because of this residual surface states, causes blinking in the luminescence, all kinds of things like that. Hard to get rid of. Hard to make this system get close to the theoretical idea. Easy to make this system get close to the theoretical idea. So I've been kind of telling you what's wrong with these quantum dots, but let me just make an aside here and reverse the question and ask what they're good for. Because quantum dots have been known now for 30 years, and these core shell structures have been known for a long time. It is clear now that the thing that they're really good for is emitting light when they have a good shell on them. You know, semiconductors are excellent emitters of light. Quantum yield is 1 as long as there's no defect present in the material. And with this quantum size effect, we can make any color light. In new Sony televisions, these cadmium selenide quantum dots are being used to make the displays as of this year. You know, one of the really great inventions of the last few decades has been this gallium nitride LED with high efficiency converting electricity into blue light. And so in an LED television, you can generate blue from the gallium nitride, and then you can absorb 1/3 of the blue in quantum dots that emit red and another 1/3 in quantum dots that emit green. And then you'll have 3 color for display with no light wasted between the 3 pure colors. And so you can make red emitting quantum dots that have a very narrow full width at half maximum for the red light, almost monochromatic, this somewhat less monochromatic. And so in this color triangle, which represents how the human eye responds to different light colors, you can, with this new green and the new red, you can generate more colors and more vivid colors than you can with the ordinary inorganic phosphors that people are using now. So that allows you to run the television with a lower voltage consumption. You have to put less power into the gallium nitride laser bar and get a better display. I don't know how this is going to work out, but this may be some kind of permanent technology, stable technology. Time will tell. I mean, the issue here is, given electricity, how to make a really excellent display for human perception with the lowest possible waste of energy. And this is close to that. 4-color display would be even better if that were important, but for a 3-color display, anyway, Sony this year is beginning to use these in the televisions. And because it's an inorganic system, because there's no organics involved here, it's zinc sulfide on cadmium selenide, you can, if you grow it correct, it will last essentially forever. much better. So the reason this can be used is because they have been made stable enough that they will run for 20,000 hours without any bleaching. That's the critical thing. What kind of phosphor you could put in there that won't fade over time? You know, you're going to pay $1,000 for a television. It's darn sure going to keep working. And so anyway, this has happened this year. Okay, so I made this little aside on quantum dots. And now I'd like to go back to the main theme of the lecture, which is correlation. So I've said that correlation is very strong in the one-dimensional system, and it's really strong in the carbon nanotube. Carbon nanotube is close to being a one-dimensional system. So in chemistry, there are other types of one-dimensional pi systems that are known. And a good one is trans-polyacetylene. So here is the electronic structure of octatetraene. This is, I showed you butadiene already, which had four electrons and four molecular orbitals. And this is now octatetraene, which has eight electrons and eight molecular orbitals, still linear piece, linear polyene. So on the left is the ground electronic state. Before it was two bound orbitals and two empty. Now we have four and four. And if you think about the excited electronic states of this system, you could promote this electron from here to here. That would give the lowest excited state. That would be the band gap transition, and it would be dipole allowed. Turns out, in octatetraene, that this is not the lowest transition. In fact, what happens is this state is this electron is excited from here, that state is excited from there, and you have a double excitation across the band gap to make a AG excited state instead of a B1U. So if you just look at the molecular orbital picture without correlation, this would be higher energy than that. But in the real molecule, this is lower energy than that. So what that means, this is a now configure iteration in the language, configuration interaction in the language of chemistry. And as this chain gets to be longer, the correlation between the electron and the hole is starting to develop. First evidence of that in a finite chain like this is this state drops below that. Now you can take this all the way to trans-polyacetylene. And here's a very interesting paper from Stephen Louis in 1999. He calculated the optical spectrum of trans-polyacetylene, just this infinite chain all the way across like that. So here's the band structure of one-dimensional chain alternating single and double bonds. And you see there's the band gap. And you expect optical transitions vertically across the band gap. And here is, again, the Van Hove singularity right at the edge here. So this dotted line is what you expect for the transitions around the gap here if there's no correlation of any sort. But in the higher order calculation, what you get is this very sharp transition that's sitting 4/10 of a volt below this thing. This, again, is the exciton in strictly one dimension. So the electron in the hole, you promote an electron, and it's interacting with the hole back and forth to form a neutral bound state in this strictly one-dimensional pi system. Same thing as in graphene. And here, in fact, is the density of the excited of the exciton as a function of the center from the center. So you see it runs from about 20 angstroms on one side to 20 angstroms on the other side. This is a theoretical solution. And it actually has very little to do with the real material because polyacetylene is a terrible material from the point of view of practical science. You know, it's very hard to get an infinite chain of polyacetylene. Maybe this is shown better on the next slide like this. And you know, so here's this alternating single double bond like this, and it runs to infinity and to infinity like this. And because you have regions that have the where this doesn't, you know, you can have regions in real polyacetylene where the bonding runs like that, and then further down the chain, the bonding runs like this. You get this soliton excited state inside the band gap. And if you actually excite across the band gap on the exciton here, the exciton will decay into the soliton state. And even worse is the fact that you hardly ever get chains like this. You have chains that have short sections, and then they have a cis bonding, and they go to other short sections. And so it's not, translational symmetry is lost in the real material, and these excitons are trapped locally. So you don't get this correlation in the practical material. The carbon nanotube is far better, far better. part of the reason is that this polyacetylene has this bond alternation, but because carbon nanotubes and graphene are based on graphene, they have hexagonal bonding. It's a two-dimensional system, so that provides great rigidity. So these carbon systems, you know, the graphene and the carbon nanotubes are very special in this sense, in a material sense. Okay. I think, as everyone in the room knows, there are lots of other two-dimensional materials where these correlation arguments might have some validity. And here's a graphene itself that I've been talking about at great length, a semi-metal. Here is a hexagonal boron nitride, almost the same bond length as the graphene, but it's a insulator with a, what is it, a 3 or 4 volt band gap like this, right? So that's great. You know, this is a metallic system, and this is an insulator. So if you wanted to have an insulated graphene, you could put graphene on top of boron nitride, and you could put another hexagonal boron nitride on top of the graphene, so graphene would be sandwiched between the two boron nitrides. That's like a silicon dioxide insulator on silicon, basically. It really keeps, it protects it from the environment. Graphene itself is very sensitive. Oops, I'm going. Graphene itself is quite sensitive to the environment because all the electrons are right on the surface. But if you put it between sheets of hexagonal boron nitride, it's just dead invariant to the environment. So you can see that, okay, another thing that we found, the community has found in the last couple of years is these calcogenides that are two-dimensional systems that have band gaps. And so let me show a picture of that. Okay. Here's the crystal structure of molybdenum disulfide, hexagonal structure like graphite, looked from the top, 3 layers thick, sulfur, metal atom, sulfur. You can do a band structure calculation on this. It's a two-dimensional system. Again, you have this question is, to what's the relevance of the band structure that you calculate to the real behavior of the material because of correlation, okay? And first of all, the correlation should be stronger here because the valence and the conduction band in the MOS2 is based on the d orbitals of the metal atoms. So, you know, so the electron is running through the d orbital like this, and the hole is running through the d orbital. And the d orbitals are narrow bands. And whenever you have narrow bands like this, it's very easy to mix them to localize the wave functions of space. You know, these correlation effects go up and up and up as the band becomes more and more narrow. This is a result in superconductivity. Same thing is happening here with respect to the graphite. So since these are d orbitals, correlation is even stronger here. There still is reduced screening. I'll talk about that in a minute. So in fact, as you go down to a single layer, there's a little bit of a quantum size effect along the c-axis perpendicular to the sheet, basically like this. There's an indirect gap here, but this gap has some dispersion along the c-axis, so this point moves up. And so this, because this peak moves up in a single layer, the direct gap is sitting lower than the indirect gap, but for 2- and 3-layer systems, it's the reverse. That was the first accidental discovery. Single sheets emit light quite well because they're direct gap, and there's an indirect gap on the multiple layer. On the bulk material has an indirect gap, also 2- and 3- and 4-layer sheets like that indirect gap. The other thing is that there are tremendously strong excitons that form on this direct gap in this system, bound electron hole pairs. And here's a picture of the luminescence. You can see in the absorption spectrum, these peaks in the absorption spectrum. You don't see continuous bands like this in this two-dimensional system like you would in graphene. You see these exciton peaks across the band gap in the system like this. When people began to do theoretical calculations on this system, and here's just one of the original papers on this, they found very strong exciton binding on these exciton. You see in the binding energy is 9/10 of a volt for the exciton that forms across the direct band gap here. That's twice the size it was in the carbon nanotube. Even though, you know, carbon nanotube is a one-dimensional system, this is a two-dimensional system, but because of these D bands, you see this tremendously strong exciton binding energy. This is a two-dimensional system. In zero order, it has translational symmetry. but it's behaving very much like a molecular system because of these very strong correlation which exists in the mixing of the zero order band states. Again, it is a region of behavior of electrons that we have not dealt with before. Lots of interesting stuff going on here because of this strong correlation related to screening and to dimensionality. Oh yeah, and so Tony Hines, my colleague, has shown recently that there even is strong trion binding energy that, you know, you have a neutral electron hole pair which is strongly bound, but even that will bound to another electron. You'll have and you can get luminescence from this bound trion state. No real analogy to that anywhere else. My colleagues have worked very hard on the Coulomb interaction, and here's something going back to Keldysh, but my colleagues, David Reichman and Mark Hybertson, just this last year, have worked on the issue of screening in two dimensions, which I've been talking about all the time. And if you consider the exact interaction between an electron and a hole in the plane, and mathematically, the material has a dielectric constant, and if you take the diameter of the material and you run it towards zero, you get an asymptotic Coulomb interaction between the electron and the hole that has both a 1 over r dependence and a logarithmic contribution in the plane. So you see we've got kind of a new regime here. It's partially logarithmic, partially 1 over r dependence, the Coulomb interaction in the plane. That has an effect on the strength of the Coulomb binding and the strength of the optical excited state pattern and everything that goes on. So I thought I would put up one slide on technology, because you can see now with this, I've already talked about, you know, the fact that you have metallic graphite and the insulating boron nitride. Then you have this whole family of these semiconductors with semiconductor membranes. That's the right way to look at these. These are semiconductor membranes, a whole family of them, 6 of them here, different band offsets and with respect to the vacuum. We really have the makings here of a new type of technology, you know, in these thin membrane systems. We have insulators, we have metal systems, we have semiconductors that can give band offsets. So here's just one picture. If you were to excite this kind of system like this, you know, you might get the electrons to go here from both sides and the holes to go here and then starting to separate charge very nicely in this thin system. Actually, in these systems, the optical absorption is not so bad, you know. If you had 3 of these layers like this, 3 or 4 of these pairs like this, you might absorb 50% of the light, you know. So you might do a lot with this, and many people, including people here, are working pretty hard with this. It is a new area of material science, and these things don't come very often in the history of our field. Okay, so that's really the first part of my talk, and now is when I have to ask how much time I have left. Who's in charge? Okay. Okay. So I thought I would talk a little bit about a less theoretical and abstract subject and a more direct experimental subject, how one changes the Fermi level of graphene itself, okay, and from the point of view of chemistry. And so I'd like to talk about strong charge transfer electrical doping to create forms of graphene which are very different than neutral graphene, and how one deals with that in terms of measurement. But first, I'll spend 2 more slides to give another little sermon, okay? This is for the graduate students in the back of the room and the assistant professors. Everyone knows this Nobel Prize came 5 years after the initial experiment, and this ought to be a real encouragement to all of the young scientists in the room. What it means is that to win a Nobel Prize, first of all, you don't have to work for an entire lifetime. The second thing is you don't have to have a lot of expensive equipment. You don't have to go to CERN. You don't have to have $2 million worth of apparatus in your lab to win Nobel Prize. You just have to have a unique idea. And beyond that, you have to have the courage to spend time working on this idea when it may not work. It may, you know, in the end, it may not work out. So what they did, as everyone knows, is this exfoliation. this exfoliation experiment. They just took a piece of HOPG and with scotch tape went back and forth and made all these torn pieces of HOPG. Most of these fragments on the scotch tape are tens or hundreds or thousands of layers thick, but a few are very thin. And then you can just take this scotch tape and rub it across a silicon wafer that has 3,000 angstroms worth of oxide on it, and then take any trivial optical microscope that exists in every lab and look through the thing and look down at the surface, and this is what you see. And remember now that single layer graphene absorbs 2% of the optical light. And so white light goes down, and some of it's reflected back, and some goes into the oxide, is reflected off the silicon, and comes back as well. And you can see where there's a layer of graphene, it's a little bit darker. One of the insights that Geim had was to choose this thickness of the oxide, 3,000 angstroms, so there would be an enhanced interference effect. You know, so basically, for this thickness of the silicon dioxide, there's the 1L graphene is acting a little bit like an anti-reflection coating, and it becomes a more pronounced optical effect to the eye than it would be for a random thickness. One layer, two layers, three layers, and so forth. It's a very simple experiment. You know, obviously it could have been done in 1970 or 1965, right, if you had wanted to do it. And I gave this talk I gave a talk about, actually, the one I'm about to give on the second half here at Cornell and in the material science department. And one of the senior professors came up to me afterwards and he says, I did do this experiment in 1970. And what he meant he was a surface science guy, high vacuum surface science. And the experiment he had done in 1970 was to have a single crystal of copper in the vacuum system and heat it up and expose it to methane vapor. And so the methane cracks on the surface of the copper at high temperature and you make carbon atoms and hydrogen atoms and the hydrogen goes away. And the carbon has a solubility in the copper, like iron, in the same way that iron forms, you know. In the same way that steel forms from iron. Anyway, carbon dissolves three-dimensionally into the copper at high temperature. Then you cool down the copper and the solubility is lowered, and so the copper comes out and segregates on the surface. And if you do it correctly, you have roughly one monolayer on the surface of the copper block. And he had a perfect characterization of this monolayer because he had the tools of high vacuum surface science, you know, the low angle scattering, lead, Auger, all this stuff, you know, that he used. So he knew exactly what he had. He had a polycrystalline single layer of graphite on the surface, you know, and published these papers. The only thing he didn't do, he didn't take the copper block out of the vacuum system and put it in an acid bath and dissolve away the copper, and he would have his graphene layer floating on top of the water. And I wouldn't have done it either if I had been in his shoes, and because he didn't think it would be important or realize it would be important, you know. So it's just the idea. I guess it's just the idea, you know, that this was important. And then, so Geim, you know, they worked on this, and if they hadn't gotten it to work, the safe thing is to do an experiment that you're going to take data and for sure you're going to publish something at the end of the experiment, right? But they tried to work on this, spend some of their time working on this exploratory thing that could be important, but maybe wouldn't work, okay? There's a physical chemist in the U.S., Dudley Hirschbach, senior physical chemist at Harvard, and he once said the most important piece of apparatus you have in the laboratory is your brain. And so no substitute for thinking like this, you know, and in fact, that's why I like this story so much because another way to say the same thing is that, you know, you can go back to your laboratory today and with the equipment in your lab today, you could certainly win Nobel Prize somehow. You know, but I can't tell you what the experiment to do is, but it's possible, okay? And the way you know it for sure is that 20 years from now, somebody will have done the experiment, somebody else, you know, with the equipment that you have in your lab now, and he will somehow or she will have thought about it somehow or found it by chance, you know. But it's possible. It's just you have to think of the right experiment to do. The choice of the problem is more important than anything else. Okay. So that's a little bit of a sermon. And let me now go to this, in the remaining 15 minutes, this back to practical experiments, okay? So as I said earlier, you know, the Fermi, everyone knows the density of states right here at the Fermi level in neutral graphene is dead zero. And that means it's easy to shift the Fermi level up or down like this. And because you just take a few electrons out of the graphene, and you'll jump from here to here, and the Fermi level will be lower like this, or you could do the reverse like this. So the question is how to efficiently put charge into the graphene sheet or take it out. And it can be done in a transistor configuration with a gate. And it can be done electrochemically, you know, with a electrochemical gate. It can also be done chemically. You put any molecule on the surface that's more electronegative than graphene, and it will pull electrons out. Put any molecule on the surface that's more electropositive than graphene, and it will put electrons in. That's not, you know, so that can be done without a gate. That's just chemistry, molecular charge transfer, interfacial charge transfer. Okay. And so here again is this picture just comparing the very funny density of states of graphene with the other types of density of states which exist in nature. Okay? Let's go ahead. So how do you know if you put charge on and off? So it turns out that the Raman spectrum of graphene is an excellent probe of what goes on in the sheet without making electrical contact. You can, from the Raman of a graphene sheet, you can determine the structural quality of the graphene as well as the position of the Fermi level. And you can, this is because, all right, so let me just talk. So what's the Raman spectrum of graphene really like? You know, so there's one allowed normal mode in the Raman spectrum. Every aromatic system that God ever made has a carbon-carbon stretch mode. So what happens in graphene, suppose you vibrate the carbon-carbon double bond like this, or the carbon-carbon bond like this. As you pull the carbons further apart and closer together, what you're doing is modulating the overlap of the orbitals from one to the next. And so you're modulating the pi to pi star gap right at that local place like this. So this makes a strong electron-phonon coupling. If you vibrate this particular vibration, carbon against the other like this, it affects the electronic structure of the system. That is easily seen in the Raman. And so, so remember, graphene is absorbing continuously across the visible part of the spectrum like this. And there's a Raman transition at 1600 wave numbers like this. And the Raman transition is coupled to the electronic part of this electronic spectrum because of this argument I just gave you. So if you change the electronic spectrum in any way by pulling electrons in or out, this net coupling between the electronic spectrum and the Raman line shifts, and that changes the position of the Raman line. So the observation is that this Raman transition will shift as a function of a change of the Fermi level. And here's another way to look at this. Here's the pristine system again. And there's a slide from Feng Wang. The pristine system giving flat absorption across the visible like this. Here's a hold-up system with the Fermi level dropped down like that. And what happens is that you'll create an optical band gap. It will no longer absorb in the infrared. If you pull the Fermi level down like that, you'll have an optical band gap which is twice the size. That optical band gap can march right across the Raman line, you know, and so you get the strong change in the net coupling. All of that's been worked out from Aaron Pinsick originally. And so basically, this Raman transition, it's a failure of the Born-Oppenheimer separation. This Raman transition for the neutral graphene sits right at 1580 wave numbers. And if you pull electrons out or if you put electrons in, it shifts to higher energy like this, also narrows in width. So we can use this Raman transition. We can use this shift of the Raman transition to higher energy as a measure of how many electrons or holes we put in there. We don't have to make electrical contact to the sheet. We don't have to apply any voltage. Just understand this is for a neutral floating piece of graphene. Okay, here's an experiment. So what I've got is single layer graphene, bilayer graphene, trilayer, four layers, and on up higher. And I, in vacuum, and expose it to a very electronegative gas, nitrogen dioxide. So nitrogen dioxide has an electron affinity, which is about 4 volts per molecule. So this really pulls electrons out. And so if we put the nitrogen dioxide across the top and the bottom, we'll pull electrons out of the graphene, and by this argument, it should change the Raman spectrum. So I've shown here that in this situation with the nitrogen dioxide on the top and the bottom, Fermi level is coming down by 3/4 of a volt. And the evidence for that is right here. So here's 1580. This is the position of the Raman line before I admit the nitrogen dioxide to the system. And then after I let the nitrogen dioxide in the system, it jumps up to 1614. And from the experiments that Pinzuk and others have done on the transistor calibration of the shift of this line, where you know the number of holes per square centimeter, you can calculate how many holes per square centimeter. I can do it also for the bilayer here. And the bilayer has, you know, the layer on the top and the layer on the bottom like this, and the holes that are spread out over two layers now. And so the number of holes per square centimeter per layer less. So with the bilayer like this, I get a similar shift, except it's not quite as far. Where something new happens is the trilayer system. Then we begin to have two inequivalent types of graphenes. We have graphene right on the surface in contact with nitrogen dioxide, and we have graphene below like this. And you can see in the Raman spectrum immediately, we pick up two peaks now because we have two inequivalent types of graphene sheets. So I'm oversimplifying it here. There's a coupling between the graphene sheets that occurs even in the absence of any doping. But with the doping, you clearly have more holes in this layer than in that layer. There's a potential difference, electrostatic potential difference, that exists between that layer and the interior layer like this. This is band bending perpendicular to the surface. You know, we're pulling charge out on the surface, and the band bending goes into the interior of the graphene some distance, and we're trying to measure that. And see, here's four layers like this, and you can see the further evolution of the peak. Okay, we can take this a little bit further, and we can go up to 10 layers like this, and you can see that you basically get two kinds of lines. When you're getting into a 6 to 10 layers like this, we have one line that's sitting right at 1580. That represents the Raman response of all the interior layers, and it shows that the holes never penetrate into the center of these 6-layer thick graphenes. And we get these lines on the surface like this that are slowly moving back and merging into the central peak like this from the surface layers on the graphene. So when you dope a graphene like this, you make strong concentration of the holes on the top and the bottom, but the center is essentially pristine. The other thing to note is that, let me see what's on the next slide here. Okay, so if we go back to this layer, you know, this graphene sample is in a vacuum and it's sitting on a silicon dioxide surface, and we admit gas to the system and we get just one Raman line, and that's a proof that the gas is going above on the side above the graphene bilayer, where that's the vacuum side where the gas is, and silicon dioxide is below like this, but the silicon dioxide is rough, and there's not a tight seal along here, and so the nitrogen dioxide can penetrate between the graphene and the silicon dioxide as well as on the top. In fact, at high pressure, it penetrates to be equal on both sides, and the proof is we just get one line. These are physically equivalent. But you can fix that. I mean, you can change it, and you can go back. Here's an experiment where we have laid 2L graphene on boron nitride sitting on silicon dioxide. And so now we have a very good, boron nitride is dead flat, remember. There's a very good van der Waals seal between graphene and boron nitride. And it's a sufficiently good seal that when you expose to NO2, it adsorbs on the top, but not on the, it doesn't, never penetrates into this layer below like this. And so here's the original Raman spectrum of the bilayer, and then we start to put in this stuff, and you can see that immediately we're picking up two peaks that are from this physically inequivalent top and the lower layer like that. So you can tell a lot from the Raman spectrum of these systems. And so this is an argument. We've been arguing based on the Raman spectrum what happened to the Fermi level, but you can see it directly as well in the optical absorption spectrum. You don't have to just argue based on the Raman. And so remember now that when you pull the Fermi level down for whatever reason, put NO2 on top of the system, you open this optical band gap. At the same time, the Raman spectrum is shifting, and in the optical spectrum, opening a band gap. And that in the infrared and then penetrating into the visible, depending upon how far the Fermi level goes down, it's very easy to measure this change in the spectrum, because you just need to send white light down like this, and you can white light reflects off the surface. And for thin layers, this change in the reflectivity is a measure of the absorbance of the layer itself. You can measure it in transmission, but with the Raman apparatus, you can just measure it in reflection like that, and it's even easier. Okay, so here, in fact, is a measurement now with nitrogen dioxide. This, remember, again, this particular sheet is the pristine graphene without any nitrogen dioxide. I showed you this before, this flat 2% absorption across the visible part of the spectrum like this. You put in the nitrogen dioxide, and what you see is here, this is the flat spectrum across the visible. With the nitrogen dioxide, you see it bleach on one side. So it's bleaching here 1.5, 1.6, 1.7 electron volts in the near infrared. And so this bleaching should be, in fact, a step function, but because there's a lifetime broadening of the edge, in fact, it's a bent like this. So we have this basically quantitative measurement of the shift of the Fermi level from this. This is about a volt and a half here. And we know from the Raman calibration, the Fermi level actually shifts 3/4 of a volt. So that's more or less the same, more or less right. OK, so I've covered a lot and probably spoken more than I could. And there's a lot more I can say on the back here. You know, basically, we've done a long series of experiments with potassium evaporated onto the graphene. And potassium's the other case. It puts electrons into the graphene, and the shifts are even larger. But I won't go through that today. I've shown you just what's possible. So I've tried to show that these one-dimensional and two-dimensional systems are, from my point of view, especially interesting because of this electron correlation argument. It makes them more molecular-like. They're not molecules, and they're not three-dimensional semiconductors. And they're halfway in between. They're hybrid systems like this. And with these membrane semiconductors, there's a lot that we can do going forward. It's a new branch of material science. High graphene charge doping from chemical absorption without application of voltage. You know, so you can make, you can think of, you have a single sheet of graphene. You put an electronegative layer on it like this. It pulls holes out. You encapsulate the thing in boron nitride on the top and boron nitride below. And you've got a different form of graphene that you can use as a material. So graphene is not just one material. It's this whole family of materials that you can prepare depending upon what you've done on the top and what you've done on the bottom. You see that these highly doped graphenes have two things. One, they become optically transparent as you dope them more and more. The second is the DC conductivity in the plane goes up and up, because initially the carrier densities are very few at the neutrality point. And if you shift the Fermi level by a volt or 3/4 of a volt, you've got a very high carrier density in the plane. So DC conductivity goes up as the graphene becomes more transparent at high doping. Band bending only penetrates in by a couple of layers like this. And you can do all these kind of one-sided doping things as well as symmetric doping. So I think this is the last slide. Oh, no, this is the part I'm not talking about. And the slide of my students got lost here, OK? So it's probably way in the back of this. It's a pretty interesting area, I think, as everyone realizes, you know. And as I say, this is, I worked originally on quantum dots, and they have some interesting properties. But these one-dimensional systems and two-dimensional systems, I think, are even more interesting, in all honesty. And we're just now at the beginning of starting to study these things as a community. And lots of interesting things to be done in the next few years. I thank you very much for your attention.
Some questions?
Questions. Yes?
When you use the nitrogen dioxide as a whole doping agent, then at the end, you form nitride NO2 minus and the positively charged graphene surface. So there will be a strong Coulomb interaction between the two layers. Will that reflect in the Raman spectrum? On the other hand, NO2 minus should have a very strong Raman active mode, the symmetric stretching of the NO2. Does that being observed as a correlation with the graphene peak, D peak?
Yeah, there's a complication. It's a very good question you ask. I mean, the complication is that you form some N2O4. So you put down NO2, but you know, NO2 has a natural equilibration with the dimerized form, N2O4. And that forms on the surface, and so that complicates things. But and so we haven't seen the vibration of NO2 minus. Although in other, you know, there are other systems where we have seen the vibrations from the molecules, but not in this case. Okay. The question of the coupling between the layer, the electrical charge, you know, you got positive charge on one layer and negative charge in the other layer, you know, and this is like modulation doping in superlattices, you know. And I especially like it because you don't have a dopant in the graphene layer. The graphene layer is still pristine. You know, it's not like we put nitrogen in the graphene or something like that. So there's no, you put charge in the graphene layer, but not dopant atom. But there is, for sure, the electrical field of the NO2 minus penetrating in. And that could increase scattering. We've not measured anything like that. But we have seen one very interesting thing in the, if the electrical field is strong enough and if it's crystalline enough, then it modulates the band structure of the graphene itself. You know, basically you can get zone folding if you have this layer on the top which has a different periodicity than the graphene layer, and the two are coupled strongly enough together so that the band structure senses the layer on the top. So the particular experiment that we have done is we have put potassium on graphene, and I haven't shown you the data, but it's right behind these slides here. And you get about 50% charge transfer from potassium into the graphene. You have all these potassium positive ions on the top. They form a crystalline monolayer, not an amorphous monolayer. And so that crystalline monolayer leads to zone folding in the graphene. And so the symmetry of the graphene is effectively lowered, and that only one Raman mode of the graphene is allowed in hexagonal symmetry. But with the zone folding, there are three modes which are allowed. And so you see new Raman modes coming up when you have a complete monolayer of potassium on the graphene. And these are graphene modes that are forbidden in hexagonal symmetry but allowed in lower symmetry. That kind of thing can be seen. We've seen it once. I mean, we've seen it with the potassiums. We haven't tried to push any further on that yet.
You mentioned the quantum dark that the Sony is using for the blue conversion to red and green. Are those a cadmium sulfide quantum darks?
I believe they are. I don't have any. You know, they're made by this QD Vision company in suburban Boston and working together with Sony, and I don't have any direct contact with them. And they're secretive about what exactly they're doing. But I believe the best luminescing dots are still cadmium selenide with zinc sulfide on the surface like that. And they're trying to use indium phosphide dots and other things like that.
So they're not commercially available.
QD Vision will probably sell you dots if you ask for them. It may be the dots that they're making for Sony are proprietary. I mean, but the thing which is good, these are big dots. They're almost 100 angstroms in diameter. They have large shells on the outside, and they've invested many millions of dollars in the chemical synthesis so they can grow a dot that big, and it will not blink, and it will last 20,000 hours in the television, operating at 200 degrees, and with the blue light, the blue laser, shining on it. But they made it work. They made it work. You know,
it has to be pumped by a laser.
Well, that's the particular application because the lasers are already being used in the television. You know, so LED televisions, they have a laser, blue laser excitation on the side already for the last several years. And this is just a way of converting this blue light, one-third of it to green and one-third to red, so you have three colors instead of only the blue. And a way of efficiently producing, you know, without wasting any energy, without producing light at other wavelengths. What you want is a pure blue, pure green, a pure red, No photons in between, that's wasted. And the color is more and more brilliant to the idea, the more and more narrow these three monochromatic, supposedly monochromatic lines are. And then if you get this, you can turn down the power consumed by the television and still have a very vivid, you know, the amount of power going to the lasers can be turned down, you still have a really bright display that perceived by your eye. It's a very big field, you know, all of these displays. They're trying to put it into solid-state lighting, you know, so the gallium nitride solid-state lighting, you'd like to have some red color in the solid-state lighting to make it more like sunlight and less like this harsh kind of white light, you know, so this is a big effort now to try and make this red quantum dot work within the solid-state lighting context.
Yes.
Material science problem.
Yes, we have been monitoring this, but yes. It's the cost and the availability of these quantum dots.
Well, I mean, you know, dots made in research are very expensive. The company spent $55 million, you know, over the last 10 years. I mean, I have no financial connection with them, but that's what they've spent. And but once you have a recipe to make it, they'll be very cheap. It's, you know, so you've got to just find the right way to make it cheap, basically. It's not like it's intrinsically expensive. It's just that they've spent all this money on R&D so far.
The drugs.
Right.
Another question.
You made the comparison, you know, for the correlation between this quantum dot and one dimension, you use a quantum dot. But actually, you can use a C60 to make comparison, right? You compare the carbon nanotubes and the quantum dots. But the carbon 60 also like a quantum dot, right? So zero dimension.
So you're right.
Quantum dot, the quantum interaction is something like a 1.1 electron volts, and the nanotube is something like 0.8 electron volts, right? How about carbon 60?
It's a very good question, and I never thought to actually do that. And the reason was that, you know, there's huge discussion in the literature about the quantum dots correlation and the multiple exciton generation, and so that was the system everybody was concerned with. And so and that's the one I've been studying. But then we worked on those carbon nanotubes, but you're exactly right. I should go back and look carefully at the correlation in the C60 because that's more relevant, right? It's more relevant.
Okay. Also for correlation, you showed some example of the electron when you inject how the electrons, you generate the electron hole pair, right? And I mean, for one dimension, this is quite strong, so that enhanced. But how this correlation, to translate to dynamics, actually, in terms of time scale, right, for this kind of generation?
Well, you know, so I mentioned there this calculation that shows that the time scale is a femtosecond. If it's allowed by energy, if you have a process of a hot electron generating an electron hole pair, and the hot electron has enough energy, and it's in a band that has the correct momentum, then everything's allowed. It occurs in one femtosecond, according to these theoretical calculations. So that's extremely, I mean, you know, there's no, anyway, really fast, okay? So, and it just basically means that you have to take the correlation cannot be taken into account in perturbation theory in the way of the Fermi-Golden rule. It has to be taken into account in zero order. And so the fundamental excitations of the systems are not hot electrons and cold electrons, but their fundamental excitations are coupled electrons. So we're not usually used to thinking in those terms. We don't really know how to think in those terms, but seems to be the case, you know, that in this one specific case, you have reached that limit.
Yeah. In the early part, first of all, it's nice talk. So in the early part, when you're talking about this electron correlation, you're using the absorption of multi-layer graphene. And then one can see actually at a high energy, there's a deviation, right? then you attribute this one to be the electron correlation effect. But how about the band bending? Because when you get into the high energy absorption, so the system is already deviated from this.
So the band bending
probably will be more.
So the band structure predicts, if you just look at the band structure without correlation, it predicts a strong peak in the ultraviolet. It predicts a symmetric peak in the ultraviolet, you know. The measured peak is this asymmetric peak in the ultraviolet. And the way that von Klintzig fit this and colleague Tony Heinz fit this was to assume that an exciton forms there and it couples with the continuum underneath it. So that's the way they get the correct line shape fit. And you do expect some kind of exciton at the endpoint, you know, where the bands are parabolic. It's just a question of the strength. What's the binding energy, you know? What's the binding energy for the exciton? Is it 1 MeV or is it? And in the curve fitting, they find it's a quarter of a volt.
Right, but then I saw, you know, near the Dirac cone, or in another words, close to the low energy, so electron correlation effect should be much bigger. Just as what you show in the later one, the absorption effect, right? You see the Dirac cone has been
so it leads to some renormalization of the properties down there, but it doesn't lead to any really pronounced effect in the optical absorption spectrum. So this is a question of what mixes with what due to the correlation, you know, and momentum conservation and how far the states are apart in energy and so forth.
Okay, one last question.
Sorry. Thank you, Bruce. So I want to ask, so graphene has no band gap. Is there any application in photo physics or those kind of applications?
Yeah, graphene has no band gap. There must be 500 or 1,000 papers, a lot of papers on use of graphene as a transparent electrode to replace ITO, you know, so it's that kind of thing. And it may—I don't know if that's the best engineering solution, but that's what many people are thinking about there, you know, in a purely electrical sense. You can, in bilayer graphene, you can get a band gap if you apply a perpendicular electric field, you know, because that perpendicular electric field will make one layer inequivalent to the other, in the same way that the doping on one side makes one layer inequivalent to the other. And I think Ando showed some years ago, or I think it was Ando, that. You know, you can open a 0.3 volt band gap in the bilayer graphene with a strong perpendicular field. And many people are trying to work on that. You know, but it's not particularly good band gap. And these MOS2 type systems naturally have a band gap. And so they're better.
Okay, well, let's thank Professor Bruce for this very exciting talk.